true?
Yes, to land this space.
Mr. Walter Gretzky, how are you, sir?
Oh, I'm fine. I'm still standing beside you.
Wow. Take two.
Just go ahead and pinch me. Go on now.
Their craft has a twin 48-foot wooden schooners, the traditional kind.
I'm Stephanie Beaumont. Welcome to See and Be Seen, the show that celebrates all the people, places, and things that make the four Atlantic provinces so very special. From Nova Scotia to New Brunswick, Prince Edward Island to Newfoundland and Labrador, we take you to where the action is. And on this special edition, action is the name of the game, because we're going behind the scenes on Mr. D.
All right, and action.
Production is well underway on this third season of CBC's hit comedy series about Jerry Duncan.
I'm gonna run to the office for a second. If anyone talks when I'm gone, they have to kiss Edward on the lips. Boys or girls, I don't care.
Ew.
A less than qualified social studies teacher and the wacky faculty of Xavier Academy. Shot right here in Nova Scotia, the phenomenal cast and crew assemble in Halifax every summer and head back to class to create award-winning TV. On this special edition, we're going behind the scenes for all the fun. We'll chat with the actors and see how it's done. Starting with the man himself, the co-creator, executive producer, writer, and star.
Check. Mr. D in the house.
I was born to teach.
The man, the myth, the legend. Ladies and gentlemen, Gerry Dee,
I
can't believe we're here.
I know, it's fun.
And look at him.
It's fun.
You guys
have fun.
Fun job.
We do.
Yeah, I mean, every take is different.
Yeah, I think that's what the uniqueness of the show. We hired, great, funny people.
Yeah, on their feet funny.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, like people like Jonathan Torrens, who you saw, who... are the best in the business, so that's why we let everybody kind of have fun, and I'm probably part to blame because I'm not, I always come in knowing my lines exactly, so, but because the ideas are kind of in my head and I've written some of it or a lot of it, you generally know what, I know what the theme of the scene is,
right.
But we have great writers that make sure that the jokes are there and the story's there. They really help guide me and the ideas and stuff.
Yeah, well, it's a great show. And you know what? I should have prefaced this all by saying, I'm standing next to a Gemini winner.
Yeah.
Hey?
Canadian Screen Award.
Well, I know they've changed it.
Yeah.
But I'm old school. And the Screen Award goes to Gerry Dee for Mr. D.
Wow. Wish the teleprompter was still going for this.
Congratulations.
Yeah, that was pretty exciting.
Are you living the dream? Like, this is what
Oh, God.
You know?
The day I started stand-up, this was the dream.
Yeah.
So you just don't want it to end. You never know.
No.
You're only
a year
away.
Going into the third season.
Yeah. Yeah,
which
we
is
hope,
awesome.
We hope it keeps going.
We love that you're here in Halifax doing this show because you've got a great group. When you talk about the team behind the production staff here, is awesome.
Oh, it's a great city. Well, as I was telling you earlier, I mean, I went to St. FX and I graduated with my teaching degree from there. My wife's from Glace Bay in Cape Breton. So
this feels like
second
home.
Yeah, her parents are in Dartmouth, her brother and sister in Dartmouth. So, you know, it's a great way to spend the summer.
Yeah.
She comes out with the kids, and we love it. It's a nice, we love the city, so it's a great fit.
Very good. Okay, now we can't give too much away,
because
January is the start.
Yeah.
But we kind of saw a glimmer of humanity, maybe, in the last episode for Gerry.
The last episode of season two?
Yeah, of season two.
Yeah.
What can we expect? I mean, there was...
Well, we tried
Miss Mason is hooked up. Were you sad about that hookup, by the way?
No.
Okay.
No, I think Miss Mason and I became... You know, the funny thing about Miss Mason is that the joke there is, like, she's the very attractive teacher, and Gerry has no interest, which is kind of like, why is that? So...
He's driving the hoop to win it all!
Gerry, are you kidding? Exams.
I didn't think you started yet. Did you see that shot I slam dunked in? I've never done that.
You lowered the basket. It's not even regulation.
Doesn't matter. But I still slammed it.
Gerry kind of gives her a bit of a hard time, and then Bill gives Gerry a hard time. And,
right.
Yeah, but
now Bill and Miss Mason.
Things.
I'm just wondering where that's going to go. We can't talk about it.
Yeah.
Give us something. Give us just a little smidge of something.
Yeah, I think you know, the big storyline for the show is, will Gerry ever teach phys ed? Because that's what he wants.
But I gotta cut you. Why don't you go down the hall and audition for Annie, okay? Sun will come out tomorrow.
All from my record.
You know, this is a shorter season because of the Olympics. We have 8 episodes,
right.
So we're trying to stick to our main cast and stick to the teaching.
You should
do
some commentary for the Olympics.
Yeah.
What about
Who
that?
Knows? Probably.
Just to make up for January. People will miss you in January.
I don't think so.
We'll put a shout out there.
Yeah.
You're busy.
You never know. No, I mean, I'm always open to anything. I love the sports world, too.
One of the greatest sports reporters in the world.
Hold on. One of the greatest golfers in the world.
I'm doing my intro right now. Just a sec. Just 2 seconds. With one of the greatest sports reporters in the world, Gerry Dee, one of the greatest basketball players were in the world, Charles Barkley.
Y'all check him out at home. He got a bunch of ones.
They know who Listen, they know who I am.
Oh, okay. No,
in the whole country.
Are you big here?
Huge. Different, big.
You, clearly you're not tall, so you must be
big. I know,
big
but
here.
I'm big here. Look at these people watching. They're not watching you. They're watching me interview you.
Fun.
That was awesome. Hilarity ensues. Okay, and we'll let you get back
Thank
to it because it's never a dull moment.
Never. Thanks for being here.
Gerry Dee.
See ya.
I love that guy. On my TV screen and on stage doing stand-up too. He's a favorite with fans all across North America, thanks to his stellar turn on Last Comic Standing and hilarious appearances on lots of talk shows. And Jerry's back on the road again this fall once Mr. D wraps. Newfoundland, you'll see him before Christmas with a show on November 29th in Cornerbrook and another on November 30th in St. John's. For a complete list of tour dates and so much more, visit www.gerryd.com. And we've got lots more ahead on this show, including a chat with another fantastically funny fella, Mr. Jonathan Torrens. But since he's doing that now, we best come clean on where we are. Oh, it might look like a school, but really, it's a curling rink. The first season of Mr. D was filmed entirely at Halifax's Citadel High. And while they still use that spectacular school for exteriors, as well as cafeteria and gym scenes, the offices, staff room, hallways, and classroom are all set at CFB Halifax Curling Club, which in the regular season welcomes both military and civilian members. For more on that club, you can visit www.cfbhalifaxcurling.com. Now it's time to meet up with a member of the Mr. D Club from the get-go, co-creator and executive producer, Michael Volpe.
What a success this show has been.
Yeah, it's been great. It's been a long time coming. Like Gerry, I met Gerry in 05 working on a miniseries, first time I ever met Gerry, and just thought he was instantly one of the funniest guys I've ever seen on camera. And we started working together, and
How
here we
it
are.
Work? Take us through it, because you see show creator, and then what does that mean? Like,
well, basically it's Gerry, and Gerry and I both did that. Yes. It's just kind of finding something, a vehicle for him, and having been a teacher for 10 years,
right.
It seemed like the natural thing for him to do, just to start telling me about stories of his teaching, and it was like, wow, it's funny, and so why not set the thing in a place that everyone is familiar with,
right.
That he knows intimately,
yes.
And can bring a lot of real life knowledge and credibility, and something that is real.
Right.
And so the thing that we try to do is have it come from a real place. These are usually stories or something that Gerry's done or Gerry's buddies have done and variations of on the theme. And then you surround him with some super talented people.
What a cast.
Yeah, I think
we
have a great cast, the best cast in the country for sure. And they're great performers, but they also are great improv artists.
Yeah.
They're writers, so everyone is really fully capable of changing things on the fly, and making it funnier, lifting the material, and so it's really good. We're really, really lucky, really blessed.
There might be some people out there who go, I have a great show idea, but it's not simple, that process.
No, if you like instant gratification, TV is not that business, because it takes years.
What happens, though? So you and Gerry have come up with this great idea, and then what, Mike Volpe?
Well, you try to get it on, get a network involved.
Okay.
And so CBC, knew of Gerry through stand-up, and then increasingly as Gerry became more and more known out there, and then he did Last Comic Standing, which was a huge thing for him. It raised his profile in Canada, and then it made it easier to sort of get a pilot done.
Okay.
So we got a pilot done, a first pilot, didn't go. So we thought we're out of luck, but we were still pursuing it because we had a strong, Gerry and I both had a strong belief that the show would be a hit.
Right.
Then we got a second pilot done, and luckily that did, in fact,
take
off. And so it was the best thing, too. So we got to work out some of the kinks and have this great cast, and so we just kind of...
And we've shooting in your own backyard, which is lovely.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
It's terrific. Shooting a show in downtown Halifax, if you live in Halifax, is terrific.
You can't beat it.
No, it's great. And it's great for the crew because they all live in the neighborhood and you don't have to drive a long ways away. And we try to keep family-friendly hours. A lot of shows...
Well, you have a lot of kids too, right? You have to keep that.
Well, we do have. We have children on the set. And so we have to be conscious of that. But at the same time, it's a marathon. Series are marathons and not sprints. So if we have to go long a certain day, we will. But we try to, pace ourselves and, bring the funny as quickly as we can. So it seems to work.
That man is no stranger to working on funny. In addition to Mr. D, his list of titles includes producer on the Trailer Park Boys, both a TV series and their two feature films, and the upcoming Trailer Park Boys 3, which Mike tells us will be released sometime in the new year. There's no denying this Mr. D gang have a lot going on in addition to the series. Take Lauren Hammersley, who plays Miss Mason. She's also a fabulous photographer and jewelry maker, too. Fredericton, New Brunswick-born Booth Savage, who plays Principal Mike Callahan, is a Gemini winner, a theater actor, and a playwright to boot. Cape Breton's Bette McDonald, who's a Gemini winner herself, is a huge hit around these parts with all her great character work, especially at Christmas time, when she and her husband Maynard Morrison and musician Ralph Dillon tour their Tis the Season show. Mark Little, Mark Forward, and Darren Rose are all terrifically funny touring comics and comedy festival favorites. I should note, too, that Mark Little is one of the founding members of the sketch comedy group Picnic Face. He co-wrote and starred in their movie Roller Town, which was filmed here in Halifax back in the summer of 2011. Another multi-talented cast member is the man who plays the much-beloved Mr. Dwyer. That's Wes Williams, a.k.a. Maestro Fresh Wes, a.k.a. the godfather of Canadian hip-hop. He's just dropped his first full-length album in over a decade entitled Orchestrated Noise, which includes tunes with Chaos, New Brunswick's Misha Brugger-Gosman, and Nova Scotia's award-winning rapper Classified. As we head to break, enjoy their collaboration entitled Reach for the Sky, Try, which also gives us the TV free stuff clue for this episode. So check that out, and we'll be right back. You can't stay down, you gotta get up. You got to get up, got to get up and try. Yeah, and when you're feeling like you never get it, you just push it farther to the limit. If you get what I'm saying, then put your hands high. And reach for the sky. Welcome back to this special edition of CNB Scene, where we're getting the inside scoop on the Halifax production of Mr. D. In just a bit, we'll be heading to the back lot to chat with Naomi Snieckus, a.k.a. Bobby. When she's done in makeup, that is. And Jonathan Torrens, well, he's issued a special invite aboard his Airstream. Can't wait to get in there. And look at this. It's the wardrobe department. Each member of the faculty has their own rack, and then there are rows upon rows of Xavier Academy uniforms, from high school senior big to super cute sweet size.
Look at that. It's Fiona Forsyth. How cool. She's been in all kinds of movies, and she works on this.
You'll find Fiona in the Cool People profiles at www.cmvscene.com. Matter of fact, you'll discover many of the Mr. D cast have shared their favorite spots in Nova Scotia with us there. Three recent additions to the Cool People profiles are three of Xavier Academy's most popular students. Easygoing Ben, played by Hans Pettersen, the smart and sassy Maya, played by Isabelle Beaupre, and that fresh-mouthed fella, Jimmy, played by Liam Sear. Think I'll snag those three for some scoop now between takes.
So three superstars of Mr. D, Hans, Liam, and Isabelle, what's it like? I mean, it seems like mania back here. Is it fun?
It's so much fun. What I like most about this show is the atmosphere here. Everyone's always, always laughing.
Yeah, it seems like the cameras are rolling and everyone, I'm laughing. You guys have, how do you keep a straight face, Liam? That's what I wonder.
Half the time you don't keep a straight face.
Yeah.
Well, why do you guys smell like a brewery?
Why do you keep smelling like a mermaid?
This is the questions I get.
Why do you smell like baby dolphins?
Why, she does, doesn't she?
Why do you smell like hope and licorice?
Yeah, licorice, hope.
Coriander stem and rose of hay. Why do you smell like black orchid and velvet hibiscus?
Kitten breath and chamomile.
Yeah, you do.
Why do you smell like hope and green tea?
Why do you smell like that stuff?
I smell it, Mom. Smells like it.
It's great though. It's always so funny, and there's something new that you know they'll say every take. So
yeah. Well, that's just, how much is ad libbing? Are you ad libbing? Do you get to just throw in a line or what?
Oh, it's probably like 50% ad libbing, or yeah. for Gerry and the comedians. And
there's a script.
Yeah.
You can use it if you want. Yeah. You know.
Is that true?
It's optional. It's very optional.
Yeah.
Well, now how was the casting for you? Because you're all such great members of the student body now, and you say to yourself, how did they land that role? Because there's a lot of young actors out there. What was the process like for you, Isabelle?
I went to the audition, and I remember being so nervous. But I actually had a teacher here second season. He was a background. And he said, well, of course you were cast. You are Maya.
Are you that smart?
I wouldn't say I'm as smart as Maya. I would not say I'm as smart as Maya.
I wish I had Maya sitting beside me in high school. I love when Gerry had his appraisal and got like a 10 because of your notebook. Right? That was so funny. I'm like a show stalker now. I know all the dialogue.
You know every single detail.
If this is not your first role, I mean, you're acting in a whole bunch of stuff. How about you, Liam? Like, when did you start?
I started when I was... as a child in a Blueberry Morning commercial.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Isn't that legal? How old were you then?
Legal. It's about one.
Really?
Yeah.
And it's just in your. And how about you? Is this your first? No.
No, I started when I was about 9 or 10.
Okay.
I had my first commercial. It was for a Bella Lyant, and I remember it was during the Olympics.
Very nice. That's our company, so we like that. How about you, Hans? What was your first role?
I was Bubbles as a kid with Liam,
that's
actually.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, years ago. Yeah, the Halloween episode, yeah.
I played young Julian
so
as
I guess
a kid.
That's our little full circle
that's
thing.
That's so funny.
Wow, it's like Oprah. Well, this is great. And thank you very much for taking the time out. I think you guys have to get back to class.
Thanks
so
much.
Back to class.
Thanks a lot. Well, we'll watch MrD season 3. Can't wait for it. Thanks so much.
Ian is from Australia, and he does sound. Right now, he's putting a mic on me. Yeah, if he doesn't work from over top, sometimes he sticks the boom in from Dean on that. The jokes never get old to me. I think they're 3 years old to Ian at this point. Ian's growing a protest beard.
Stop the jokes.
He'll only shave when I stop making fun
stop
of his
thing.
But you notice he has no hair on top of his head, only Deananda.
It's funny.
His first name is Austrial, and his second name is Ian. So he's Australian.
He kills me. Jonathan's getting mic'd up for another scene, so we'll catch up to him in just a bit. Now's the perfect time to meet up with Comedy Award winning actress Naomi Snieckus, who plays the sporty Bobby Galka on Mr. D.
You're right there. What if you...
I feel like a stalker. Is that wrong?
Oh gosh.
Like
yes.
I follow you.
Yes.
Well, I follow you on Twitter.
That's
I'm like
okay.
up to I was like, Naomi, where is she today? She's doing this, she's doing that. But you never stop.
Like
is that
doing
right?
stuff?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm
you're
busy.
Constantly like creating and...
Because I like to challenge my stalkers. I don't want it to make easy. Because if I was just doing one thing, they'd be like, oh, just go watch her at her home. She's always there watching TV, super boring stalking. But if I'm like all over the place,
right. Hard to catch
challenging.
Up. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Like me, but I found you here today and I'm really glad of it. So now before we get into the whole Bobby world,
okay.
I just want to ask you about this thing you have with your fella. It's this
nice fella, Matt Barham.
He, the two of you, it's like a improv invitational. Is that pretty much it? How does it work?
Well, Matt and I met at Second City, and so when we left Second City, we knew we wanted to start something of our own. So we started a company called the National Theater of the World, and so now we create shows. We created a show, Impromptu Splendor, that tours internationally. So you go to Germany and Israel and Amsterdam, all these great places, and then we have another show
that we call the Scriptease Project, when we've asked playwrights to write us two pages of a play that's never been written, and then we read them for the first time in front of the audience, and then throw the pages down and improvise the rest of it.
I think it was Mark O'Brien you just asked.
Oh, so that's our other show we do called...
Is that something else?
I Seen You on TV, where we have, like, friends that are on TV that will come and improvise with us. So Mark used to improvise, and then he didn't for a long time, right. And I was like, you've got to come. And so I think he was a little bit nervous, but then, like, he was like, oh, yeah, he did. He said, I'm a little bit nervous. And then he's, like, on stage singing.
Oh.
Improvised singing, which is like people's least favorite thing to do, and it was a riot. We had people, like, we had Ennis Esmer from The Listener,
yes.
And Mark Forward from our show came, and
right.
Every month it's a different cast,
my
so it's really
God,
fun.
Woman. Okay, and now the one other thing I just saw, Colin Mockery, what was that? It was a casting...
Oh, so I have a web series called The Casting Room, and it's, I know,
it's hilarious,
it's,
though.
It's sort of...
You're way too busy to answer all your phone calls, so I thought I'd drop by and show you my stuff.
Well, it's really wonderful, but I've got you down for the grandpa role. Channing is the love interest, and he's supposed to be very young.
Yeah, and you're not.
What?
Is that improv, or you
no,
go with
a
concept?
No, we script that.
Okay.
And then if people bring things, like, you know, somebody like Colin Mockery, we're not going to say, no, that's a really good line, but it's not in the script, Colin Mockery. So they bring their own
right.
thing. Like Suresh from our show did one. And, we'll hopefully get more people from Mr. D to do it.
Oh,
but yeah,
it's so fun.
It's super
and
fun.
And then
to
you
do
that with another lady.
With Stephanie Gorin.
Now, is she a real casting?
Actual casting
okay.
director. Yeah, she casts like Haven. And what else she cast around town? I'm trying to think.
I was saying she's so brilliant. She must be real.
She's fantastic,
right?
And she's so dry,
yes.
like in her comedy sense. It's so fantastic.
Okay, now let's talk, Bobby, because we're
okay.
here on Mr. D, and
yes.
you. I still marvel, you know, being here. I could barely keep myself contained. I got lectured, you know,
yeah,
watching
yeah,
the
no,
monitors.
Yeah, no, I get the
How
yearly lecture.
Do
Please
you
don't laugh.
Get through the scenes?
Like you chewing gum, like your gums, not a gum, but like the blood kind of gets in the way of makeup. But I don't know. You know, you hope that you lose a take because you laugh at one take, but you get on.
Because they're different every time.
Yeah. I mean, that's what's funny is when somebody like you're working with Gerry and Jonathan and suddenly they do something that you didn't see coming and you're like, oh, you got me.
Yeah.
And so you just try to keep it together. You breathe deeply.
Right. What can you tell us about Bobby? Now, where is she going?
What
do you know so
can
far?
I tell you? I don't want to give too much away. She's just tough, right? She's not overly...
Will she ever give Gerry the break he's so desperately?
No! Does not deserve it.
The time has finally come to connect with Jonathan Torrens, who plays Xavier Academy's vice principal, Robert Cheely. He's as funny off camera as he is on, so you never know what topics will be on the table for our talk.
Can we talk about the little animals?
Yes, like what a collection there.
I have to, that's only a few members of the family. A few years ago, I was doing a show for the Travel Channel in the United States.
Right.
And I wanted to collect something that wouldn't break in my suitcase. So I thought, I don't want to get spoons because they're of no use.
Sure.
I already have a mug collection, not to brag. So I started to buy little animals. And the first thing that I bought was in Hawaii. It was this little frog drum right here. You ready? Incidentally, the noise heard after most of the jokes that I tell.
Oh.
So I started to buy these little animals everywhere I went. The llama, I got that bear in Banff. That's Helen, the giraffe. She's actually a pincushion. I got her in Ogallala, Nebraska. That's Marlin, a gift from my friend Mike Lattenberg. Because what happens is when you start to collect something,
right.
every birthday, every Christmas, every holiday, people are like, well, just get them a little animal. So suddenly I was that guy.
Your animal guy.
200 animals, like
no.
little animals. And my wife was like, you know where those animals should go is not in our home
She's
anymore.
Very stylish,
she
right?
She is indeed.
So
the little animals, some of them have found a home in the Airstream trailer, and some of them found a home in the bottom of our garbage box.
Aww. Well, I love them. And we love being here today. Now, Jonathan, what is this like? Because we watch it on TV and think it's hilarious. Is it as fun to make?
Mr. D?
Yeah.
It is.
No, what are you doing in this trailer? Yes,
well, we're making tiny animals. It's a tiny animal workshop. Hey, do you want to see my...
What?
This is my African thumb piano.
You know, this actually bridges nicely into what I like to call your burgeoning music career, because I wept. I'm going to say wept. Tears of joy, some sad. Sometimes when we touch, that was...
There's a guy who works on the show named Mark Forward, and we're both married, but I don't think it's overstepping to say we're especially fond of each other. The thing about working on a show like this is it has such a deep bench. Gerry's really funny.
Yeah.
Mark Little's really, really funny. Naomi Snieckus, Mark Forward. Bette McDonald is
yeah.
amazing.
Yeah.
The list goes on and on and on. So Mark Forward and I had to find an outlet for our affection, and we opted to express
our bromance musically. Romancing all the strategy, got me battling with my pride. Through the insecurity, some tenderness survive. I'm just another writer, still trapped within my truth. A hesitant prize fighter, still trapped within my youth. It's a hard thing to explain because it is born out of genuine fondness.
Sure.
It seems creepy and it seems like we're being cheeky about it, but it is actually sincere.
But it's a great group. I mean, that's what I think going to work. Can you imagine working with all these people? It's a dream, eh?
Well, it's such a cliche, but every day that I look at the call sheet, like, oh my gosh, I'm with Mark Little tomorrow, I'm with Bette tomorrow. It is like summer camp.
Right.
The hours are great, the morale is high, the people are nice, there's lots of laughs at work.
Right.
And you get out in time to have a swim in a lake.
What's it like to work at home? Because I know, like you said, you traveled everywhere, but working here in Nova Scotia, not bad.
I made a lifestyle choice to move back here from California several years ago, inspired in part by my audition to host America's Cutest Puppy. True story. No. I had to say into camera during this audition, tonight the canine move into the mansion and we'll see what, like, you've got to be kidding me. Wow. I'm pretty sure that's not a show. So I got in the car, called my mother who lived here,
yes,
and asked her what she was up to. She said, I'm going to a dentist appointment tomorrow. And she's nervous about going to the dentist and she's going to be going alone. In that moment, I thought, do I want to be the guy who hosted America's Cutest Puppy, or do I want to be the guy who took his mom to the dentist? So I begged to get the America's Cutest Puppy job, and they wouldn't give it to me. So I moved home, took my mom to the dentist, and the rest is history.
Come on.
But truthfully, I thought when I moved here, I'll go back to school, I'll be a realtor. I don't care what I do for a living, just living in the East Coast was more important than anything.
Yeah.
I could have been offered The Tonight Show or CNN or anything, and living here was better.
Oh, nice.
So the nice kind of upside to that is work has flourished in ways beyond my wildest imagination.
It really is. I mean, you're going from movie project to TV shows to hosting duties. I mean, you kind of have got it all going on.
When you don't do any one thing particularly well, I've discovered it helps if you do a few. And that's the way we are on the East Coast, right? A farmer's also a mechanic. You also have to know a little bit of plumbing.
Oh, that's fun.
But Call Me Fitz happens here. Trailer Park obviously happened here. Mr. D happened here. I did my own little show here. So I think born out of, in part, the fact that when you're in the States, you have to rely on such a big network beyond the end of your own nose to kind of generate opportunities.
Right.
That when I came back, I had so much restless energy and so many ideas that I really wanted to get going and was really excited about it.
Yeah.
Coupled with the fact that when you're back from somewhere else in this part of the world, that can be a newfound credibility.
Yeah.
So I'm just surfing that.
When you're as talented as Mr. Torrens, you are always in demand. And speaking of demand, let's dole out some TV free stuff. Up for grabs, a limited edition CNBC t-shirt. It can be yours if you can tell us which Nova Scotia rapper did Maestro Fresh West team up with on Reach for the Sky, Try. I can't stop singing that song. It is so good. When you've got the answer, hit the website. It's www.cnbc.com. Click on the TV Free Stuff button and submit your answer. Good luck to you. We'll be right back.
It's Alpha, take one, A-Mark.
B-Mark.
Like I wasn't a fan of Mr. D before, coming to this set has made me love the show even more. Watching the production and chatting with the cast, it's been awesome. If you're just now getting hooked, or maybe you want to see your favorite episode again, well, you'll find all the shows from season 1 and 2 online now at www.cbc.ca/MrD. They are so funny. And there's still so much more to see here on this special behind-the-scenes edition of CNB Scene. Let's head back outside. So this would basically be what they call the back lot. Now, we were in Jonathan's trailer earlier, and we're actually going to go in with all of the...
That's going to do it for CNBC and this time around, for all of us on both sides of the camera. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.
We wanted to do a little bit more of with the stars and the trailers.
Actually, there isn't. That's all the time we have. We'll see you next time on CNBC. For Stephanie Beaumont, I'm Jonathan Torrens. Thanks for watching.
Just a little bit more of the show.
Pretty sure that's all the time we have. Out of time. No more time. Too bad it wasn't an hour-long show.